Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah and peace be upon you all, and welcome to our second MKA UK podcast. And today we're going to be discussing the Tahriq-e Jadid, the New World Order. It sounds pretty scary. What is it? We're going to be looking at this and looking at the history of how this was actually founded. We're going to look at a time where a group called Majlis-e Ahrar actually stood up and it claimed that they would not rest until they had wiped out the Jamaat, of course, Ahmadiyyat, from the face of the earth. Now, the leader of the Ahmadi Muslim community at that time, the Caliph Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu anhu, he replied to them by saying that, "I see the earth slipping from under the feet of the Ahrar. They say they will wipe out this Jamaat, but Allah Almighty has told me of a plan with which the Jamaat will spread in all countries of the world and no one will be able to destroy it." Now, the question is, from this moment in the past to now in the present, where we see the Ahmadiyya Muslim community truly spread across the world and is a positive fighting force for the world, how did it not only survive this threat, but actually thrive and become such a productive organization, benefiting tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people around the world? We're going to be going on this journey to figure this out. But before we do, we do have, of course, our guests who we'll be speaking to today. We have Raza Ahmed Saab, who is a missionary of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. And later on, we will have Nasser Ahmed, who is overseeing the Tahriq-e Jadid from the Amiya Muslim Youth Association perspective as well. Now, of course, we do hear about the Tahriq-e Jadid a lot. People kind of assume, Raza Saab, that it is actually just a chanda. It's actually just a charitable act. A lot of people actually wonder, is this not actually an innovation? The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that really only sadaqah and zakat are mentioned in the Holy Quran. These are the only two obligatory ways that we should spend in the way of God. Then what is this new innovation? We also have other types of chandas in the Jamaat. Are these all not what we would class as a bidah? So I'll turn to you for this straight off the front of it.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Jazakallah, first of all, for having me. That's actually a good point, but it's the simple answer to that is it's no. If you look at the lifetime of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, whenever the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in need of financial contributions, if they wanted to go on an expedition, if they had anything else to do, then he would call the Sahaba, he would say to them that come and spend in the way of Allah. And we know the famous example of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq Razila Talanhu and Hazrat Umar Razila Talanhu, where they would vie with each other who would bring the most. So Hazrat Muslim Maud radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu has also said about the Tahriq-e Jadid, though it is not it's not compulsory for you to pay the chanda, but if you know about it and if you don't pay and if you don't contribute, it's not about having millions and millions of pounds contributing to the scheme. It's just about taking part of the blessings, being part of this blessed scheme. So if you don't take part in this, although the Khalifa of the time, first of all, has said it, then you might not be held accountable in this world. But in the next world, as a Muslim author has said, you will certainly be asked about that. So no, it's not an innovation. And look, to run the day-to-day things of an organization, you cannot do that without money these days. If you are part of a club, you have to pay membership. If you are part, if you're driving a car, you have to pay insurance. So these are the things which are used to run the daily things of an organization.
I mean, I understand you're trying to say that these are, of course, not compulsory funds. But my question really is that do Ahmadis at the same time, are they also paying chanda, are they also paying sadaqah, are they also paying zakat, or are these things kind of put to the side and is more emphasis sometimes put on these things? Is that the case?
I'll tell you one very interesting fact. If you look at the receipt that is issued by the Jamaat to the members of the community if they pay chanda, at the top, it's not chanda am, it's not wasiyat, at the top it's zakat, and that's where we start off with. Look, you cannot neglect that. The Jamaat is not introducing anything new. The rules of Islam, the Sharia, they fully and completely abide, are abided by in the
I think it's quite clear. You're trying to say that, of course, the obligatory charitable acts like sadaqah and zakah, they are also very important. Ahmadis also do that. But you're also arguing that it's proven from the history and the acts of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that spending in other charitable ways, whether it's building mosques, whether it's helping people, whether it's helping the cause of Islam, that's allowed, and you're allowed to do that. That's not an innovation. But can you actually prove that these funds, which are collected by the Ahmadiyya community from their members, are actually being used for purposes which are justified, or are they being funneled away for, you know, questionable things?
The policy of the Jamaat is transparency. Of every member of the community, whether from any country, from any walks of life, whatever society, country, nation you belong to, you have the right to find out where your money is going. And look, if when it comes to Tahreek al-Jadeed, it's not being used to buy flashy cars, it's not being used to buy material things for members of the community or even Khalifa Vak. No, it's for our benefit. If you go to any country in the world, you will find a masjid, you will find a mission house. You can go to that mission house, you can go to that masjid and pray and even stay maybe even the night. And that is done for us, for the members of the community. Nobody is having any personal gain from the chanda that we pay to the Jamaat.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I mean, you're basically saying that none of these funds are obviously used for the personal expenses of the organizers, the administrators, but you're saying that rather these funds are used for humanitarian projects, other construction projects. Do you have any really figures to actually prove this point?
Every time, every year at Jalsa Salana, Hazur Anwar Eid al-Attar ibn Aziz, he announces what is the Jamaat doing. For example, when it comes to the progress of the Jamaat in 2020, we have distributed 9.3 million leaflets, again, propagating the message of Islam. We have built 217 new mosques across four continents, 124 newly built and 93 existing mosques. Again, these are not mansions that are bought for individuals. You have 97 new mission houses. You have 360,000 plus books that have been printed for the propagation of Islam. And you have saved $5.2 million by volunteering. And these are the members of the Jamaat, which is also one aspect of the Tahreek al-Jadeed.
I mean, and beyond this, I'm sure that we all actually know.
This is just the beginning of the list.
Yeah, there's hospitals, there's schools, and the list, like you said, is endless. We could talk about this, and I think it's quite clear that, of course, these are the things which the charitable donations are used for. But we know that Tahreek al-Jadeed is not just a charitable donation. It's rather actually, it's actually a way of life. There's much more history to Tahreek al-Jadeed than just being a chanda. So really, my next question is that we can see that in the present day, Tahreek al-Jadeed has taken on the form of something which is positively contributing to society. It's whether it's humanitarian, whether it's spiritual. But where did this all begin? And what were the things which made people actually want to go and do these things?
So, as you mentioned, in 1934, Hazrat Muslim Aud Razila Ta'ala Anhu, which was in November 23rd, 1934, the Majlis-e Hirar, you had a community, you had an organization that was out to not just verbally, but now the time came that physically Ahmadis were being targeted. So it wasn't just merely opposition and saying, oh, you're wrong, you're kafir, you're this or that. No, they physically wanted to wipe out the Jamaat. And for me personally, when I found out about this and when I read more about the demands that Hazrat Muslim Aud Razila Ta'ala Anhu made from the community or wanted the community to adopt, it's surprising that out of these 19 demands, I'm not sure, what would you guess? I mean, when I asked a lot of people in my Jamaats or in different forums, when you think of Tahreek al-Jadeed, what's the first thing you think of? The first thing, automatically people think about, oh, chanda, probably, you know, financial contribution. But out of the 19, only one of them, just one of them, talks about financial contribution. The rest, the remaining 18, they talk about what we have to do, what we have to change within ourselves. How should we behave? Where should we be morally? Where should we be spiritually? Where should we be when it comes to the relationship that we have with our fellow human beings, with the members of the Jamaat as well as non-members of the Jamaat?
Okay, that's really interesting. So you've got various demands that actually maybe are not commonly heard of: leading simple lives, you know, dedicating yourself to the service of Islam, you know, offering children for dedication as well, and even things like keeping the roads and your city and your environment clean. These are demands of Tahreek al-Jadeed. And obviously these are things which are much greater and form a larger part of a code of conduct of life. So these are, of course, the demands. These are the ways that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community was asked to step up in light of the threat of Majlis-e Hirar and other organizations. So we had this threat where supposedly the opponents of Islam, of Ahmadiyyat, wanted to destroy Ahmadiyyat. And the solution to this threat by the Muslim world, which was given, was these demands to step up. But my question is, how did then the Ahmadiyya Muslim community step up? How did they actually use these demands to actually make Islam successful? And how are we able to see the Jamaat standing on its own 2 feet today? So we're actually going to turn to, Nasr Sahib now as well. Nasr Bharti Sahib, who here is here for from the Amir Association, is overseeing Tahreek Jadeed as a national executive. As-salamu alaykum, are you here with us?
Jee, as-salamu alaykum, Kamar Sahib. Thanks for having me.
Jazakallah. So my question really to you is, like I said, we have seen that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community was under threat. How did it go from being a threatened a Jamaat, a community that was, had its existence in question? It went from there to a community which has not only now survived, but has become so successful. What was the key ingredient in having it through that?
Yeah, so we have, several examples of how Jamaat members came forward in the early days. So, for example, in 1936, just a couple of years after the launch of Tahreek Jadeed, 1,300 members of the Jamaat committed to do voluntary work during holidays. And similarly, another 200 young members dedicated their lives for the service of the Jamaat for 3 years. Mm-hmm. However, I just want to mention one really faith-inspiring incident.
Okay.
And this is, again, from the early years. And it's related to one of the initial urgent instructions of Tahreek Jadeed, where, Hazrat Muslim Maud Razi Allah Ta'ala Anhu asked for men who are prepared to leave their own countries for the needs of the Jamaat to come forward. Mm. And so upon a hearing of this and the scheme in general, one young man left his home of Sargodha and decided to go to Afghanistan. And he went without a passport and started doing tabligh there. Right. So sooner rather than later, the government found out about him and actually arrested him and imprisoned him. He went into jail. Okay. So, however, that didn't deter him. He was in jail and he started preaching the guards and the inmates of the prison.
All right.
And in turn, started actually influencing them. So the situation got really sort of escalated, and the prison officers decided to, officially file a complaint against him. The mullahs also issued a fatwa for his death, because, in those days, the death penalty was around. So the situation escalated and it went in front of the commanding minister. But here we see the miracle of Allah Ta'ala, that the commanding minister said that he's actually a subject, this member of the Jamaat, he's a subject of the British Empire. Remember, India this time was under British rule. So he could not be killed. He had to be sent back to India safely, and that too under the protection of the Afghani government.
Okay.
So such an amazing incident. So there's it goes on to state that when this young member went back to India, to Qadian, he met Hazur, and Hazur actually said to him that you should have gone to a different country. And his reply immediately was that, please tell me which country and I will go this very instant. So, it's such a faith-inspiring incident that he's forgotten all the ordeal that he's gone through. Firstly, it would have taken him weeks to get to Afghanistan. He got imprisoned. He went through that whole lot of the anxiety, that, fear factor. And we see the miracle of how he's able to get back. And then he was still ready to go anywhere he was instructed to do so.
So kind of what you're saying is that the way that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community survived these threats was literally the very members of the community gave up everything that they had. They gave up their time, their wealth, their lives, literally. And they went out and they preached what the true message of their community was, what Ahmadiyya really stood for. And that, in essence, won the hearts of the people. And I think that's what has been shown in the past, that these people who made their sacrifices went out there. They really illustrated what Ahmadiyya really stands for through their own character, through their own sacrifices. That, if obviously, evidently, has won the hearts of the people. And those people who have now seen the truth, they cannot see or believe anything wrong about the Jamaat anymore. And that's exactly what these people have done. So really, that's what they have done in the past. These are the sacrifices that they have made by following these 19 demands, whether it's leading simple lives, whether it's propagating the message of Islam, whether it's donating, whether it's many other ways. How can we, in this day and age, especially since this is an MKA podcast, how can the members of AMIA, MKA, Majlis Khudam al-Ahmadiyya, actually, in a similar way, step up in this day and age and try to propagate further this message, this mission?
Yeah, so how Khudam al-Ahmadiyya is related to Tahreek Jadeed is that, first of all, there's some key instructions that Hazrat Muslim gave directly to Khuddam Lemdia.
All right.
But before that, I just want to mention in February 1953, Tariq-e Jadid was introduced to the departments of Khuddam Lemdia for the first time.
Okay.
And then from then on, Tariq-e Jadid actually became formally part of the constitution. But as I mentioned, you know, there were some instructions and there were some addresses that Hazur gave which talked about Khuddam Lemdia and Tariq-e Jadid. So, for example, in November 1938, just 4 years into the scheme, Hazur said that Majlis Khuddam Lemdia is the army of Tariq-e Jadid. Okay. Right. And he hoped that, you know, many people would join this army and understand their responsibility. So, you know, understand the 19 demands, understand how Hazur wanted us as Jamaat members to live our lives. And then in another address in 1950, Hazur really set out the expectations quite clearly and in fact took a pledge from Khuddam Lemdia. This address was to Khuddam Lemdia directly. It was a Khuddam Lemdia event. And Hazur said that the pledge I want you to take is that if there's any Ahmadi in your village or town who is not taking part in Tehreek-e Jadid, you should try to make him part of it until there should not remain a single Ahmadi who does not take part in Tariq-e Jadid. So it's interesting that the above is not just for, you know, office bearers or Qaideen or Amla members. This instruction was for every member of Khuddam Lemdia. It's our responsibility to promote the scheme and ensure that every member of the Jamaat is part of the scheme and receives the blessings that are associated with the scheme.
Absolutely. So this is really a huge responsibility for all of the members of MKA to really step up, understand the responsibility. We're going to really end off with that note. And I think it's food for thought for everybody listening as to what we now need to do in our personal capacity to try and carry on this great mission. And of course, this project, Tehreek-e Jadid, we know is actually called the New World Order. Many of you might be thinking, the New World Order sounds pretty scary. It sounds something similar to what we might have seen in the past, like other revivalist movements, which were also prevalent at the time of Tariq-e Jadid, like communism and Marxism. We do not need to draw a comparison to them, whereas they were political movements with political objectives, where Tariq-e Jadid, the New World Order, is not about a change within the political system in effect. It's rather a change within our spirituality, a change which we first bring in about within ourselves, and that automatically illuminates other people as well. We have seen, and you can also after this go and check out the 19 demands, and you will yourself see that these demands are in no way political. Rather, they are those which demand a change within our own character and in the way we conduct our lives. Having said that, I hope you enjoyed today's podcast, and we will, inshallah, of course, be releasing one podcast every single month on various important topics relevant to our youth. Until then, stay safe, stay home. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah, and peace be upon you all.